respected our beloved faculty, Dr. Anoop Kumar Reyes, KDC President, Dr. Shaji K. Joseph, sir, who has been Dr. Anil Kumar S., our State Secretary, Dr. Deebu, Ramanova, sir, CD Chairman, Dr. Faisal, our IDA CAN Secretary, Dr. Dinesh, our Technical Head, Dr. Unni, other office bearers of IDA Kerala State, and dear members of IDA Kerala State. A warm good morning to all. As coronavirus strengthens its virulence across the world, more than 2.8 lakh people sacrificed their lives before this pandemic. It is the need of the hour of each and every dentist to keep abreast with the knowledge of this pandemic. Now, more than 45 days over with the lockdown, we dentists are all in a state of anxiety and fear. This deadly potential virus affects almost all areas of our life. We salute all the frontline warriors, health professionals, government authorities who fight against this deadly demon coronavirus. Now, our Chief Minister, Mr. Pinarayi Vijayan, and Health Minister, Srimati Shailaja teacher, striving hard to set an example as Kerala model to the whole world. Hats off to Chief Minister and Health Minister and their health team for doing wonderful things for Kerala. Now, more people are coming to Kerala from foreign countries, from neighboring states. So, we should be more vigilant against this virulent virus. Corona will stay here for some more time. So, let us arm ourselves and face it wisely. In this lockdown period, we dentists, we are acquiring knowledge through webinars and hibernating in our own nests. In this corona pandemic episode and the post-corona, the dental treatment scenario has to be changed. We need to change our practice modality. The behavioral and structural changes needed in our practice pattern. Now we are facing a global health crisis. Coronavirus is abundantly present in the nasopharyngeal and salivary secretions of the affected patient. So, we dental health professionals act intelligently, not only to provide care, but at the same time prevent any nosocomial spread of infections also. So, today, we have with us an eminent faculty, Dr. Anoop Kumar Reyes, Chief of Critical Care Medicine, Baby Memorial Hospital, Calicut, recognized for Nipah detection and containment activities in 2018, which is the only reference we have against a virulent attack in Kerala. So, the doctor has received the Best Doctor Award by IDA Kerala. Government of Kerala, and now actively involved in the COVID prevention activities and as a member in expert advisory panel of Kerala government. So, on behalf of IDA Kerala State, I extend a warm welcome to this webinar, sir. So, IDA Kerala State extends a warm welcome to our ever-loving mentor, our panelist, Ramanova, sir, former principal, GDC Calicut. And IDA Kerala State also extends welcome to Dr. Shaji K. Joseph, President of Kerala Dental Council, as our panelist. We extend a warm welcome to Anil Kumar, sir, Dean of KUHAS, to our panelist. And IDA Kerala State recently released COVID-19 guidelines. Our CAN Secretary, Dr. Dinesh K.R. is the man behind that. A hearty welcome to Dr. Dinesh K.R. as a moderator to this function. Also, I extend warm welcome to all the office bearers, Dr. Deebu, our secretary, CD chairman, Dr. Faisal, technical team, Dr. Unni, and other office bearers and other members of IDA Kerala State to this webinar. Let us extend sincere congratulations and gratitude to the CD wing of Idea Kerala State and all the participants of this webinar. So stay inspired with the most relevant topic of the day. So let us know more about our enemy from an eminent faculty, a research personality, Dr. Anoop Kumar Reyes. Thank you, sir. Welcome to this function. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Joseph, sir, for a kind introduction and nice words. And this is, I think, the second time I am getting associated with an IDA event, an educating event. The first one was in Calicut, I think, during a West Nile fever outbreak. So that time I got an opportunity to communicate with your members on the antibiotic policies and again other viral outbreaks. So that time we were not expecting a COVID outbreak anyway. Then after that, in Anjarakandi Dental College, there was one more session on antibiotic usage in dental practice. So this is the third time, and again, very nice to be with you in this Sunday morning. So welcome to this event. So,
okay,
can I proceed with the presentation, sir? Or?
Faisal, hello.
Yeah, just I'll just introduce the panel.
Okay, okay.
Before that, secretary can have his remarks, please.
Debo.
Yeah, good morning.
Morning.
President Dr. Joseph, our faculty Dr. Anoop, the eminent panelists Dr. Shaji, Dr. Anil, and Dr. Ramanova, sir. Thank you for being here. The moderator for the day, Dr. Dinesh, thank you. And the CDE chairman, Dr. Faisal, is the man behind this program. Thank you all for attending this program, which has a lot of significance today, especially in a situation where we need to understand whom and what we are fighting. We have created a comprehensive guidelines for the members of IDA Kerala State, for the dental profession in general. And today's session, I believe, will have a lot of significance because it will throw light on the enemy, in a popular term, the guest virus that we are fighting today. Because this virus is not from our land, it has come from another land. And we need to understand the guest and what it is. And that is where our eminent faculty, Dr. Anoop, will throw light in. So I should thank you all. And this has a lot of significance in relation to the guidelines which was created with the help of all the panelists and our moderator, who was the man behind that. So I request all the attendees today to listen carefully to what Dr. Anoop has to say and to use it in our practice. Thank you all for being here and wishing you all a happy learning. Thank you.
Respected President Dr. Joseph CC, Secretary Dr. Deepu Matthew, Faculty of the Day Dr. Anoop, other panelists, moderator of the day, and my dear IDA members, a good morning, warm good morning to all of you. I have been interested to introduce the guest of the day in this series of webinar, Know Your Enemy, All About COVID-19. Dr. Anoop is very familiar to us. He is working as the Chief of Critical Care Medicine in Baby Memorial Hospital, Calicut. Dr. Anoop was recognized for Nipah detection and containment activities in 2018. He received the Best Doctor Award from Kerala Government and also the Kairali TV Best Doctor Award for Nipah-related activities. Now, he is actively involved in COVID prevention activities as a member of Expert Advisory Panel of Government of Kerala. We welcome you, sir. Our panelists for the day, Dr. Ram Mohan, sir, was a professor of oral pathology and former principal of GDC Calicut. Other panelists are Dr. Shaji K. Joseph, who is the president of the Kerala Dental Council. And other panelists is Dr. Anil Kumar, who is the Dean of Dental Sciences in Kerala University of Health Sciences. This program will be moderated by our own member, Dr. Dinesh K.R., who is in the charge of IDA CAN. And over to you, Dr. Anoop, for this lecture.
Thank you, sir. So good morning, friends. And again, first of all, I would like to thank IDEA organizers for giving me this opportunity. And as even WHO mentioned, the prevention concept of the COVID-19 that lies in knowing the scientific basis of the disease, like how it is going to affect us, how it is spreading. So by knowing all these scientific facts only, we will be able to design the preventive measures related to our profession. Like if you are a dental surgeon, to know like how to design these activities, you should have a clear-cut idea about what is happening and what is the like scientific aspects about the disease. So I'm just trying to give you an overview, like the situation of the disease in the world, in India, especially in Kerala, what is the present situation, and again, like how it spreads, some infection control measures. I'm not going to touch in detail about the dental aspects because I've seen a guidelines prepared by an IDA. It is an excellent guideline, like each word and in that is very useful and scientifically prepared. And even the hyperlinks are given from where the points are taken. So I think they will be sharing that document to all the IDA members. So I don't have to repeat all the things what is like already mentioned in that document. That is why I've just excluded all those parts. And during the panel discussion, we can discuss about all those things. And using this platform, as you can see, you can see in the down, like the question Q&A, and again, there is something like a chat also you can see here. So either by using these things, you can give your comments. In Q&A, if you have any specific queries, you can keep typing that towards the end. The panelists will sort it out and we will try to discuss with the help of eminent panelists here. In the chat, you can put the suggestions during the presentation, like during my presentation, any slides or any areas I'm covering, if you have any doubts or if you want more clarification on that, please put it on the chat window so that I can clarify then and there. So with these, we will move on to the topic per se. I don't think you need any introduction on this thing because the disease per se, now it is called COVID-19. Because initially it was called novel coronavirus because this is a new coronavirus. And this is only the disease. The virus is called SARS coronavirus 2 because we had a SARS disease before. And that was also a coronavirus. So this is almost mimicking the SARS virus. That is why we call it as a SARS coronavirus 2. So the disease is COVID-19 and the virus is SARS-CoV-2. Now coming to the coronaviruses, we had so many coronaviruses, but among that, 6 were significant. So these 4 were the common coronaviruses which were producing common cold and upper respiratory symptoms. Then we had SARS coronavirus way back in 2002. Then after that, in somewhere around 2012, we had MERS coronavirus in the Middle East. And now we had this SARS coronavirus, which was initially called novel coronavirus. So these are the 7 coronaviruses that is affecting human beings. There are many other coronaviruses that can affect animals and sometimes can produce symptoms, sometimes may not produce symptoms as well. I'm not going to the in detail about the things what has happened initially, but as you are all aware, the disease was started in Wuhan, a city with almost 11 million population. So the doctors in that area noticed some unusual viral pneumonia in a group of people who had visited to a seafood market there. Then later on, like all the routine viral screening for those group of patients were negative. And by about January 8th, they identified this as a new coronavirus, and even it was declared by WHO. And even the sequence of the whole viral genomic sequence was declared to the whole world. So that is how the disease started. Then gradually the disease has spread to the neighboring cities like Seoul and Hong Kong. And here actually these cities were initially, to contain the disease, the China closed down these cities. So that was a shocking news to the whole world and especially to the medical community, because we have not heard about like a city being closed to contain a disease, or a country or a state being closed. So the China took a bold step at that decision. Sorry, at that point. And it was extensively criticized at that point, whether closing down an area is really going to harm the people by increasing the mortality and increasing the spread in that area, or really whether it is going to help us. And even it was debated in such a way that they are sacrificing the lives of people in Wuhan and these three cities to save the other part of the country and again this Hubei province. But later on, it was proved that that is the correct method of containing the disease, and now world over, this is being practiced. And this was the connection with the Wuhan market. I've already told the Wuhan had a Haunan seafood market. So initially thought that this was like spreading from some snakes, then later on thought it is from somewhere from the bats. But the from the initial paper itself, you can see the red one is with the persons exposed to the market. The blue are one without exposure to the market. So you can see almost half of the initial patients were not exposed to the market at all. So this point is still unclear whether the disease has started in the market itself or before. I'm not going to the controversies about that, but this point we also know. Then because of the globalization, the disease which was started in Wuhan, within few weeks it started spreading to different parts of the country because Wuhan was a travel hub of China. It was connected through air, road, and the rail with other parts of the country and across the world. So immediately after like this disease was declared, before this travel was completely banned, the people started moving around. And even in Kerala, we had almost 3,500 people returning from China and mainly from this Hubei province. So from out of that 3,500, mainly medical students returned to the state, we identified the first case in India on January 30th. So that is how it was started. And the cycle of the disease is usually we will be having an imported cases followed by case usually imported from the countries. That is the stage one. Then we will be having a local transmission. This is a phase where we are lying now. We are in the present situation. And then we have the community spread. That is the third phase. And there is a epidemic phase. So we will go to that later. So this is the today morning figures. So few days back, like when the China was affected, when they were reaching 10,000, 20,000, and when they reached 80,000, the whole world was looking in a panic way that China got 82,000. Now see the situation. China is in the, you can see, 10th position. So there are 9 countries who has already reported more cases than China. The US has almost reached 10 lakhs. Then you can see the other European countries, UK 1.6, Germany 1.5, Turkey, Russia. And unfortunately, India is also heading towards the initial first 12 countries. So this is these figures are not updated from India, I think. So altogether, we have almost 30 lakhs cases across the world with 2 lakhs deaths. So this is spreading all over the world. So you cannot keep away from this disease. That is what we are learning from everywhere. And one more point I wanted to stress at this point is the Singapore was actually projected world over the way now the Kerala is projected as the best model of prevention because they had experience in dealing with the SARS before. And they have nicely contained the disease, but even they are not able to contain the disease and they have reached numbers of 16,169. And even the community spread is suspected in that country. So that is the situation world over. And you can see that Russia is also heading towards 1 lakh. So Russia was the country who was ready to go and help the US with all the medical equipments. So even now, they are affected. But there is some strange thing what you can observe. See, even Russia, when they are reaching 1 lakh, the mortality is only 300 here. But US, it is almost 56,000. And even UK, when they have affected only 1.6 lakhs, they had 21,000 mortality. And India also, the mortality is comparatively less compared to some other countries like Italy. So there are many factors in that which we will not discuss in detail. Coming to this diagram, you can see the cases was initially starting like this, spreading over to different parts. Then you can see it was coming down. The whole trend is actually narrowing down. So that is a good trend. It is getting contained. But different countries are having a different pattern. I'm not going into the details about that. And again, you can see the countries like US, they are the plateauing the curve. UK also, Italy, all the countries are plateauing. Now, mainly India, Russia, and Brazil. These are the three countries with an exponential growth. So that is why the numbers in these countries are increasing. Obviously, I think India, we will hope that India can plateau the curve, but all other countries have really plateaued the curve. And the China, you can see how beautifully they have touched the bottom line, but still the cases are getting reported there. So this is the present situation here. You can see the total cases, like as on today morning, 8:30, 62,000 cases are there across India, with 41 active cases, and 20,000 have recovered, and the total death is almost 2,000. And you can see the states like Maharashtra, they have very badly affected. The total numbers are 20,000, and the death is also very high there. You can see the Gujarat, Delhi, Tamil Nadu, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, all these states are very, very badly affected. But here you can see, I have told you, we are the state who reported the case in January 30th, and we were the first position like few weeks back. From there, we have like almost, we are now in some 13 or 14 position. So this is the importance of having proper containment. And here you can see how beautifully we contain the disease in our state. Like we have almost touched the baseline without much active cases, even, and the confirmed cases also, we have really plateaued that. So this is because of the excellent effort by the state government, the health department, and obviously by the public participation. Without public participation, you cannot attain such a beautiful graph and containment. So we should know how we attained all these things. That is very, very important, because now we are all discussing about the people who are coming back from Gulf countries, whether we can accommodate them or are we going to lose our control. So before that, we should know how we attained all these things. And again, that time we were not quarantining the quarantine was not done in the quarantine centers. They were allowed to go home, and even some people didn't adhere to the quarantine policies as well. So how it was done? Extensive quarantine contact tracing. The experience with Nipah really helped us. We have, at one point of time, the number of quarantine people were somewhere around 180,000. The quarantine adherence was assured with the help of the healthcare workers and even the Janamaitri police. The testing was done appropriately, because even now the Kerala was criticized for doing lesser number of tests. Then how we attain a best outcome? It is by doing the test for the most appropriate people, and again not wasting the test, and early detection of the cases. The mortality was very, very less, because all the cases were detected from the quarantine area itself. They were immediately shifted to the hospital. Any minor change in their variation in terms of oxygen saturation, symptomatology, etc., was detected early, and they were given appropriate care. And as I've already, the last slide, appropriate care was initiated at the proper time. It is not that a new treatment was tried in Kerala. All over the world, these experimental treatment were carried out. So we were also doing the same thing, but it was done at an appropriate time. So these are the measures by which we were able to touch the line to the bottom. And with this experience, I'm 100% confident that even if more people are coming from the Middle East, we will be able to contain the disease. See, this is the one. This is the why we were we were criticized. As you can slide, you can see the Kerala was one in 500 per million population testing. And there were countries like Iceland with more than 1 lakh per million testing. Even with that lesser number of testing, we were able to attain a position which is much better than the country which tested more than 1 lakh per million. So that is how you have to apply the scientific knowledge in the prevention aspects. So to see how beautifully we have touched here in Kerala, the total active cases are only 17 now, and we have tested only 40,000. We had 505 confirmed cases, and you can see the active cases is almost touching baseline. And again, the active cases are also getting plateaued. So, and again, so now we have almost 505 patients, 23,000 people are under observation, and 34 in hospital, and 23,500 in home, and 123 suspected persons are hospitalized. We have 17 active cases. So what we should know here is, we had almost 360 persons returned from Middle East, and from that 360, usually by this time, even if you take all the measures, it should have been somewhere around 10,000 or even more. That is what we have observed in other states. They were not even having 360 imported cases. Maybe Tamil Nadu was having more than 1,000. Other states were not having these many number of imported cases. Even with these all imported cases, with the proper containment measures, we were able to contain it to 145 numbers. That is why the total number were reached to 505. So from Nizamuddin also, we had these many patients, only 18 tested positive from 120. So this is the present status now. You should all look at these maps. Different maps are available in the website. So we are dividing it into different zones, red, green, orange, etc. And this is basically for the administrative purpose. Don't confuse it with the medical things completely. So how to do the different administrative aspects in this area. These areas, districts were designated. We have Kannur and Kottayam being in the red zone now. And there are many hotspots also, which you can, with the help of these graphs, or if you go to the Government of Kerala website, you can know like which are the hotspots. So these hotspots will be having severe restrictions, and it is better to take more attention to the persons coming from hotspots, especially in terms of dental procedures. Now coming to the disease per se. So first thing what you should know about the epidemiology is, there is a secondary infecting rate, or reproductive index. We call it as R0 value, even though we write it as R0, we read it as R0, so R0 value. So usually in COVID-19, it is about 2.5. That means one person can infect almost 2.5%. So this is how the disease will be exponentially increasing. If the value is only 0.8 or 1, the numbers will be gradually coming down. So your aim should be, with all the preventive measures, you should be able to reduce the R0 value to less than 1, so that the progression can be prevented. So how we can reduce the R0 value? This is what we should know, especially as healthcare professionals, and we should be able to explain to our friends and relatives as well. So reduce the susceptible persons. So who are the susceptible persons? Without any immunity, they will be susceptible. So how can we get the immunity? You have to give a vaccine, but we don't have any proper vaccine. You can debate that the persons with herd immunity won't be having the disease, but again, still in a debatable situation. We don't know whether these diseases are going to really make a herd immunity, and how long that will be protective. That depends. We have to wait for further reports. So here, the vaccine is not an option for us. Then you can reduce the viral load in a patient by giving a proper antiviral. Many drugs are tried, even antiviral drugs are tried, but even at this point, none of these drugs are found to be very effective. So if you have an antiviral drug, you can immediately reduce the viral load and the spread can be prevented. So only option left with us is the non-medical public health interventions like quarantine, isolation, social distancing, and behavioral changes. This is the point where we all should stress. And the behavioral changes should be applicable to all persons in the medical field. One fact we all should understand is, we are not going to stop this disease. That is impossible. The complete eradication of the disease at this point sounds very illogical. So only point possible will be, you can contain the disease and we will have to live along with the disease. So for that, you should make the behavioral changes. Like, there are many things, including the hand hygiene, other infection control measures, and many other things. So one important thing as dental surgeons, what you can practice is, Like I'm a doctor working in an ICU. So the one thing we always do is the bare below elbow policy. You can see, like, we never, I'm not in the ICU now, but still, we will always keep the below elbow without any ornaments or like watch or even the sleeves. We tuck like we tuck the sleeve and again keep like that. So these policy we can adopt for all dental care practitioners as well. So how these diseases are spreading, if you see, this is something called a flattening of curve. We have a maximum number of patients whom can be accommodated. So if the numbers are increasing exponentially, we may not be able to control that. And to do the containment measures, we should be able to delay the peak and we should try to flatten the curve. Okay, so that means you may not get a peak numbers and your hospitals will not get filled up like in Italy or now happening in Mumbai. So this is how we should reduce the number. So we cannot like reach a point where it is completely touching. Even in Kerala, even though we have touched, obviously as the outsiders or like the persons are coming from other affected areas, obviously we may able to or we may be increasing the numbers. So this concept should be very clear. And again, this is other concept about the disease. When you plot the time course about the severity of illness, you have a initial viremic phases which gradually slows down. And in this viremic phase, in the initial days, we'll be having maximum infectivity. So, and as the symptoms advances, it is basically because of the inflammatory response. It's not because of the proper viremia. So even if the patient is very sick with the lung findings and other organ failures towards the end of 10th day, it is basically will be the inflammatory response and they may not be very infective. So based on that, you can divide the cases into different classifications and the severity also will be like progressing that way. So initially the patient will be having only mild symptoms, progressing into breathing difficulty and severe respiratory failure. And the treatment and the signs are also designed accordingly. Now, this classification also should be very, very clear. Like you have four groups of patients here. One is without any symptoms, that is up to 30%. Those with mild symptoms, which belongs to almost 55%, and with the severe symptoms, which is almost 10%, and the critical illness patients, which is almost 5%. So the mild symptom patients will not be having any symptoms at all, but they will also develop immunity. Okay, they will be infecting for the initial few days, but gradually their infectivity will come down. And if you do a PCR test, that will be positive during those days. In mild symptoms also, initially they will be also having an asymptomatic phase, progressing to the mild symptoms, sometimes which we may not be able to detect, and they also will become immune. And their infectivity also will be like this and can be tested positive accordingly. And the 10% of patients, you can have severe symptoms, requiring hospitalization, and they will also become immune. So here the issue is, you can see the hospitalization is occurring at day 9th or 10th. Till that time, they will be having only mild symptoms. Okay. So though even those who are recurring in hospitalization, they may be stable in the initial days, and they also will be having a phase with no symptoms. So what you have to understand is these no symptom phases are there in all the groups. Even in the severe group also, they are having a no symptom phase, progressing to the ICU, and half of them will die, the severe patients. So this, the asymptomatic phases are there in asymptomatic group and all the other symptomatic group as well. So here, what you have to, the infectivity also will be like that. From the no symptoms to the mild disease, the infectivity will be persisting. Now, if you see the other parts, like the patient will be having fever and cough after this is the point from where the person is exposed. Then the patient is developing fever and cough. Then the patient will be having dyspnea later. And the infectivity will be usually from, mainly from day 2 days before. And again, it can last up to 10 days. Okay. So this is the area where you have to suspect more. Even I don't know, like, whether I am going to develop symptoms after 2 days. And your patient also, you may not be knowing that whether they are in the pre-symptomatic phase. So that is a main challenge. And to know the infectivity, actually, you have to do a viral culture and isolate the live virus. Then only you will be able to say that the person is really infective. Your PCR positivity, because this was the point which was discussed extensively in the media, the patient, the PCR getting tested positive on day 20 or even day 30. And there are literature reports for PCR positivities up to 62 days. So keep in mind, having a PCR positivity will not correlate with the infectivity. If we are just detecting viral fragments there, that doesn't mean that the person is infective. And the same way, you have the antibody will be developing from day 3 or 4 of the symptoms. But even before the antibody is getting developing, you will be having a phase where the persons can be infective. That is why even the persons who are returning from Middle East, even if you do an antibody test, you may not be able to detect the persons at this point. And obviously, they can become positive at a later time. The same way, and IgG will be developing at a later time. And if you have an IgG also, that also doesn't tell you that the person will not be infective, because he can be in this part where he continued to be infective for a few more days. And the incubation period means that is from the time of person exposed to the time of symptom development. Okay, so by doing a PCR test on day 40 and showing the PCR positivity, you cannot say that incubation period has extended up to 40 days. Incubation period is only up to symptom development, and that is always less than 14 days. So this is the incubation period. There are many studies where everywhere it is shown somewhere between 2 to 14 days. And as you can see, the maximum number of infectivity is happening between day 4 to day 6. That is why now the Kerala is adopting for 7 days the institutional quarantine and another 7 days in home quarantine. Because if one person is like carrying the virus, they are likely to show the symptoms within the 7 days. Or even if they are getting infected during the flight or during the travel, they are likely to show the symptoms in first 7 days. So this is the scientific rationale behind the present Kerala state decision. So this point I've already discussed. Even after the onset of symptoms, they can stay very mild symptoms, later on go into severe symptoms. This is very, very important. As a healthcare worker, you should know that. These are the data from China. You can see this blue are the number of persons getting infected. You can see the number of persons getting infected are mainly from 40 to 40, 30 to 39, and up to this group, because these are the persons who are going to interact with the public more. Okay, so if you are an younger age, doesn't mean that you will not get infected. But see, if the age is more than 65 or more than 70, the mortality is very, very high. That is why we should try to keep these persons away from such fields. Even the dental surgeons who are practicing, you should definitely keep away from the aerosol generative procedures, because if you are getting infected, the chances of dying will be very, very high. So in your house, you should try to do the reverse quarantine. In your profession also, you should try to do the reverse quarantine. And this is the way by which you can reduce the mortality. So you should be very, very clear about this concept, I feel. Now, regarding the transmission, as I've told, the pre-symptomatic transmission is happening in 45% of the patients. Okay, so this is mainly those who are having symptoms also will be having a pre-symptomatic phase. Then we will be having a symptomatic patient spreading 40%. Then later on, the environment is spread. That is very minimal, like the place where you touch, someone else touches there and getting infected. Those things are very minimal. And the so-called, so much discussed asymptomatic group, they will be spreading very, very minimal 5%, because they don't have that much viral content in their secretions. Okay, so you should be concentrating on these pre-symptomatic phase and the asymptomatic 5, because altogether these asymptomatic patients constitute 50%. So these people are going to be the real challenge in the healthcare sector, because we cannot identify these patients without doing a proper testing.
There's a question being asked.
Yes, sir, please.
Yeah, from Shamsul Huda. She asked that some reports say that the virus is spreading even after 28 days. Is such a thing possible?
No, that is why you should not getting confused with the viral spreading and the PCR positivity. The PCR positivity is entirely different. That is not a surrogate of infectivity. The surrogate of infectivity is either a viral culture or there is something called a subgenomic mRNA PCR. So till now, no published papers are there where the virus isolation has happened after 10 days. Only one paper has shown that an 18th day, they were isolated the virus. That is only one case isolated report.
So that means, if a person is positive in the PCR test after 28 days or 30 days, that doesn't mean that person is infective. So that's what.
Sure, sure. Yeah. Only initial 10 days only a person can be infected. Okay, yeah. We will discuss that later. So okay, coming to this slide again, this is very, very important. As a dental surgeon, you should be very, very clear about that. We are all worried about the airborne spread. See, even this is a COVID patient. The airborne spread means, depending on the droplet size, if that size is more with the more something like more than 50 microns, they will settle within 1.5 meters. Okay, they cannot transmit more than 1.5 meters. So if the particles are very small, they can get suspended in the atmosphere and can travel up to 6 to 10 meters. Okay, so even if it is an airborne infection, that cannot transmit the disease more than 10 meters. But as a dental surgeon, what you should understand is, if your clinic is a closed space, even if that the patient, if you make some droplet, that droplet can get suspended in the atmosphere. And even after some time, the person coming to that area can get infected. That doesn't mean that if you are doing a procedure in one room, the next room person get infected. It should be very, very clear. The transmission distance cannot be more than 10 meters, average 6 meters. And this airborne infection is a doubtful thing. WHO has accepted, CDC has also accepted. But still, the main mode of transmission is droplet spread. So our concentration should be mainly on droplet. So obviously, we should be able to airborne precautions also when you are doing a aerosol generative procedures. But to the prevention part, we should be concentrating more on droplet preventions, which I will come to later. So these are the symptoms which already your guidelines is also clearly mentioning. Because of shortage of time, I'm not going in detail, but keep in mind, you can have an infected person without fever as well. Having a fever is it is not necessary that the patient should have fever to have a COVID. You can have a COVID patient without fever as well. And there are many other symptomatology as well. This will be available in your YouTube. You can see that later as well. So coming to Dinesh's question again, see, this is the days where the patient is getting infected. Your infectivity will last only up to 3 days before the symptoms and maximum up to 10 days. The PCR positivity, this is what you are telling the virus is isolated. It is not the viral isolation. The viral particles are detected. So that can go up to 62 days as per the reports now. 62 days of PCR positivity also has been established. But the infectivity is unlikely to last for more than 10 days. Okay. So your all policy should be based on that. That is why we have also changed the discharge criteria based on that. So previously it was test based, only if PCR is twice tested positive, the persons were discharged. Now it is symptoms based and time based. After a PCR is being positive, you can wait for 10 days, and if it's asymptomatic, you can discharge. Based on the symptoms, if you're having a symptoms after 10 days, last 3 days, if he's asymptomatic, he can be discharged without further PCR. So now the discharge policy is based on symptoms and the time. It is called time based and the symptom based discharging strategy that even our country has adopted that. This is regarding the symptoms. I think Dr. Dinesh has given a beautiful link in your document. Please take that. Now coming to the testing part. So as healthcare professionals, you should also clearly know what is this testing, because this rapid antibody testing, all those things have created so much confusions, especially in Kerala. And again, regarding the mentioning about the testing, you should know where and all the virus can be isolated. The first thing, these viruses are getting bound to a receptor called ACE2 receptors, and these receptors are seen in respiratory and GI tract. So the patients will be having virus mainly in respiratory and GI secretions, and the symptoms also will be mainly on these systems. And the maximum concentration will be in the bronchial fluid, followed by sputum, nasal swab, pharyngeal swab, etc. The feces and blood, the incidence are very, very minimal. So this is a very, very important point you should all know, because see, this is the nasopharynx lies here. I think you will be knowing better anatomy than me regarding the nasopharynx. And when we take a nasal swab, we should try to get the swab from the nasopharynx by going through the floor of nose, then reaching the nasopharynx. So why I selected this picture here is, see, there are many arguments in your groups. I have also seen that if you do a mouth gargling with some preparations, like even a chlorhexidine mouth gargle, the viral load can be reduced. It may be true that the load may be slightly reduced, but see, you cannot reach the nasopharynx by using the gargling. It is not possible. Okay, and even if you put a nasal drops, you will have to irrigate the nose with huge quantities of chlorhexidine. But even then, these viruses are bound to the receptors. You cannot kill all the viruses. So giving some antiseptic solutions and killing the virus, it will not be a scientific idea. In your common sense, that may sound good. That is what even the American president was saying, to inject all the persons with these antiviral solutions or antiseptic solutions. So that is in common sense, that may sounds like that, but in scientific aspects, when you consider, it is impossible. So now coming to the test again, you can either detect the virus or you can detect an immune response to the virus. The viral detection can be done either by a nucleic acid test or by viral antigen. So in the world, the viral antigen tests are being in an experimental stage. None of the tests are approved by any authorities. Antibody tests are two types. You can have three types. You can have a CART test, you can have an ELISA titer, and there is a neutralization test as well. This nucleic acid is usually by PCR. Different methods of PCR are there. I'll just go through that a bit. So this is the rapid test where you put the drop in the a drop of blood in the cart, and you will get a line there. I will explain that. So usually when the patient is becoming symptoms, so the symptoms will appear and gradually will settle down. And so this is the RNA detection. So RNA, the PCR, if you do from the before the symptoms onset itself, you can test that. Then later on, the IgM will become positive. Maybe a slight delay between the symptoms and IgM response. That is why, even if you check the travelers with the CART test, you can miss the persons in this area. And later on, they can develop other symptoms. So this is the usual CART test where you can see a line there. So put a drop of blood there, then you will get a CART test positivity. And these are the different proteins the virus is having, like a spike protein, envelope protein, membrane protein, etc. Why knowing this is important is, the antibodies are developed against all these proteins. So still we don't know which antibody is really protective. We assume that the spike protein antibody is protective, extrapolating the data from the MERS studies. Still we don't know that this spike protein antibody is really protective. And there are many targets of the gene. So in the PCR test, you will be looking at different targets. So basically in a confirmatory test, you screen with one target, like an E target, and a confirmatory with an RDRP or ORF1 or S. Okay, very simple. You have to look at two different genetic gene target to confirm the test. For a screening only, you can test envelope gene. So envelope gene, nucleic capsid gene, or RDRP gene, and again, or many genes are there. So just an overview. So whom to test? We cannot test everybody. That is what you all should understand, because there is a national ICMR protocol. So whenever they approve any lab, they will take an undertaking from the lab saying that we will be testing only the persons as per ICMR guidelines. So as per ICMR guideline, a persons with an international travel in last 14 days with symptoms, this now may be outside states also we can include, or symptomatic contacts of lab confirmed cases, symptomatic healthcare worker. If you are really becoming symptomatic, you are eligible to get tested because you are a healthcare worker. All hospitalized patients with severe respiratory infections, like anyone developing a severe pneumonia, should be tested. Or if patients are asymptomatic, but they are having a direct contact with a confirmed person, even if they are asymptomatic, they should be tested between 5 and 14 days. Okay. These are the persons whom we tested at day 48 or something. We cannot test them. After 14 days, we should have tested between 5 and 14 days. And now in the hotspot area, you can do testing for all symptomatic in ILI. ILI means influenza-like illness, fever, cough, sore throat, or running nose. So with these symptoms also, the persons from hotspot should be tested with the PCR initially, or in the second week antibody, but antibody tests are not available at this point. So the, regarding the infection control measures, we should try to limit the human to human transmission. That is the first importance you should give. You should reduce the secondary infection. That means from the infected person, it should not go to another person. And prevention through the amplification and super spreading events. That is the especially the healthcare area. So you should not be a focus of these infections. And the most important thing is cleaning hands. So as a dental surgeon, this is the most important thing you should give importance. After touching and before touching all the patients, you should use a proper surgical hand rub or you should do a hand wash. So coming to your organization, what the organization can do? So you should identify the hazard the way Dr. Dinesh and team has already done. Then you have to assess the risk as a healthcare workers. What are the risks involved in your that? How can you control the risk, especially reducing the aerosol generating procedures, taking control of the persons from the hotspot? And again, how to review and maintain control measures, like a body like yours should continue to review the guidelines and should maintain the control measures. The guideline what you publish today may not be applicable after a month's time. So you will have to keep on reviewing that. So this is the policy for any hazard when that is infecting us. So what are the things what we can do? We can eliminate that hazard. We can substitute that. You can make engineering controls in your clinic. You can make some administrative controls the way we have already suggested by the IDA, or you can have the personal protection equipments. So physically removing the hazard, it is impossible here. Substitution, you cannot replace this hazard. That is also impossible. So these things we should understand is a reality. We cannot eliminate and substitute. So what is possible for us only? We can have engineering controls, we can have administrative controls, and we can use the personal protection equipments. So coming to these 3 points, what we can do regarding the engineering controls, you can like isolation rooms or some that is basically in the hospital setup. But in a clinic setup, you can avoid the closed rooms. You can make it more ventilated. I know that many clinics are already closed. You don't have enough ventilations, but if possible, like even the operation theaters, we are suggesting that. So if possible, keep the windows open, have an adequate cross ventilation so that the airborne, which I've already told, the airborne infective materials can be reduced. The administrative controls, like you should, the engineering controls should also include the barriers, like which I've already discussed. You can have some goggles or the face shields to reduce the exposure. And the ventilation systems, even if you are having a AC, you try to reduce the recirculation if you are in a bigger hospital. Like the air should not be recirculated and that air should not be sucked from one room and again go to other areas. So especially if you are a maxillofacial surgeon or something, if you are having a clinic, so and if you are working in a hospital, the air sucked from that area should not go to a different area, because if this patient is getting an infected patient, definitely these can spread to other areas. Okay. Another simple thing what you can do is, like especially to convert your clinic, you put an exhaust fan in your clinic. So even if you keep an AC on, your electricity bill may go high, but this exhaust fan will keep on changing your air in the room and again will definitely reduce the airborne particles there. So putting an exhaust fan in the clinic also will be a good idea. Or keeping the door open and again keeping an exhaust fan in the other end. Now coming to the administrative controls, like we try to reduce the number of persons involved. Like even if you are getting a patient inside the clinic, you tell that only patient can be allowed, don't take any relatives or bystanders to the clinic. I do admit that if the patient are like sick or need support or like pediatric group, that may not be possible, but you should use your thinking process at that point. I think that has been also very clearly told. The visitors should be reduced. The source control should be done properly, like the PPE, all those things. You should follow the image protocols. Then the healthcare workers also, if you are having symptoms, you should definitely keep away. As I told, as a healthcare worker, if you are developing symptoms, you should get tested. And again, if the proper time itself, you have to do the testing. Regarding the PPE, again, it's nicely given in your document, like which are the procedures where you have to do the PPE and N95 mask. So what I suggest is, do you go with the same guideline And if it is an aerosol generating procedure, you should use an N95 mask. And even if the proper PPE is not available, even in our ICUs, like I'm working in an ICU, even in our ICUs, we are not getting proper PPE. So the best substitution will be, as many of your members have already put in the social media, you put a normal surgical gown. So that will definitely help you. But the same surgical gown, you cannot keep it till the evening because the outside part will be already infected. So you should not touch that. So maybe for a few patients, you can use that. But obviously, the cross-contamination issues will be there. Ideally, you should use only for one patient. I don't know how practically we can decide that during the panel discussion. I think we can take that point. So N95 mask, which all areas to be used, you should know. And the difference between surgical and N95 masks, there are many differences. I'll come to that later. So you should know how these pathogen, what are the reservoir, there is no reservoir here. And again, the portal of exit, I've already told where the virus is. And again, the transmission, how the transmission is happening. Then the portal of entry, it can enter either through the GI or through the respiratory tract or from the conjunctiva as well. So you should have a clear-cut scientific evidence about that. The susceptible host, I've already told, who are the person who are likely to become more sick with the symptoms. So all these ideas, you should have a clear-cut knowledge. So once you have a knowledge about all these things, so keeping away from the disease is very easy. Coming to the standard precautions, very beautifully given in your document again. I'll just go through once again, hand hygiene, personal protective equipments, respiratory hygiene, if you have a cough or something, they should cover that. And another thing I wanted to highlight, even if you are getting a bystander to your clinic, they should be always using a mask. They should not be allowed without a mask inside your clinic. I'll explain that again. The safe injection practice, sterilization, environment cleaning, all those things. So the transmission-based precautions are mainly for contact precaution, droplet precautions by, again, mask, airborne precautions, that figure it should have been an N95 mask here. So here, airborne precaution, mainly you use an N95 mask. Droplet, even a surgical mask is enough. A surgical gown is enough for contact precaution. So a contact and droplet precaution is enough in majority of the procedures, but like an aerosol generating procedure, you need like airborne precaution also, mainly you need like an N95 mask. This diagram we have already described. This is again like the droplet the droplet, and again the way how it spread two ways, which I've already mentioned. Now, this is another doubt everyone is having. Why we have advising universal masking for everyone? I'll just finish in another 10 minutes. So here again, what you should understand is I've already told the main mode of spread is through the droplet. And we have 50% of asymptomatic spread, including the pre-symptomatic persons. So to prevent the spread from that group of persons, if you advise them to use a normal cloth mask, all these droplets will be filtered at this point itself, and they cannot spread the infection because being asymptomatic, their viral load will be low, and they are asymptomatic, they won't be having any aerosol generation also. So in that case, by putting a normal cloth mask, you will be able to prevent the spread from these group of persons. That is why the universal masking should be advised. And it is not to protect yourself. And it is basically, to prevent from you to infect your friends. Okay, that concept should be understood. This is again, which I've clearly told before, the main concentration of the virus is in the nasopharynx. It is not in the oropharynx. And again, there is a reservoir in the respiratory tract as well. So whatever the solution you use in the throat, you cannot reduce the viral load. It is impossible. Okay, maybe viral load a little bit may be possible, but you cannot eradicate the virus. So that concept should not be practiced. The mask can definitely reduce R0 value. Even the European countries like Czech Republic, they have really showed that. Like many countries have adopted the universal masking and they were able to depress the curve very effectively. So universal masking should be encouraged. And as a healthcare worker, you should tell all your friends and relatives that you should not come out of your house without having a proper mask. A normal cloth mask is enough. Now, this is very, very important. As a dental surgeon, you should have a clear-cut idea about this thing. So what is a respirator and a normal mask? A respirator is to filter very, very minute particles, that is aerosols or airborne infections. So here again, there are different categories of masks. Like if you see, there are FFP1, FFP2, N95, N99, P3 and N100. So this is based on the filtering capacity. Okay, so N95 can filter up to 95%. FFP2 is the European licensing authority. N95 is a NIOSH licensing authority. Okay, an Indian company cannot have an N95 certification. That is actually fake. Okay, if any Indian company is producing an N95 mask, that means they are just making a duplicate. Okay, if you go to the NIOSH site or USFDA site, they have already given like what are the approved or NIOSH certified mask. So it doesn't mean that you should you should always go with a NIOSH certification. You can go with an FFP2 certification. Now what I understand is like ICMR is also trying to make a certification. So if that is available, we should make sure that that certification is there. One thing you should be very careful is there are FFP1 masks available. That is basically an industrial mask with a filtering capacity of only 80%. So that is not advised. And again, you don't need an N95 and an N99, FFP3 or N100, which is having a 100% protection. That is actually not required. If you are having, it is well and good. So different types of mask are there. N95 can have 95% filtering capacity. Here you can see the number 8210. There are different numbers. If you go to the NIOSH site, you can see you should use only the brand with that number, or you have an FFP2 respirator. This is another confusing part. Everyone is having a feeling that if you have a valve like that, that will be having a more efficiency. So what is the purpose of having this valve? This valve will filter the when you take the air inside. Okay, but when you are exhaling out, it will not filter. So you will not get a suffocation. So you will be having a better feeling. But what is the harm? So as a healthcare worker, if you are having virus in your throat, or if you are an asymptomatic person, you will be infecting your patient because it is not getting filtered. So you should never use a mask with a filter in a COVID situation. Okay, it should be very, very clear. I think that part we can include in the guideline at a later time. So you should definitely mention that the mask with the filter should not be used in COVID situation. It is to protect the public and your patient because you don't know whether you will be a carrier. Okay, and there are other FFP3 and N99, which I've already mentioned. There is another certification called KN certification. This is a Chinese authority. So even KN N95 certification is also the efficacy wise, it is as good as the Chinese one. Sorry, the NIOSH certification. But the problem is with the Chinese, the guidelines, how much you can depend on these KN certification, I really don't know. But if it is properly certified and if you can check with the Chinese sites, I think that can also be adopted. And the repeated usage of these masks will definitely reduce the efficiency. I'll come to that. And this is regarding the efficiency of the effect of wearing and the mask infection rate. Even the normal mask, it can have almost 80% of the protection, which you already told, a cloth mask. Here again will be reduced. Here the infectivity will be even less. So this is very, very important. As a dental practitioner, you can all start applying this to your practice. Like suppose a virus enters to any inanimate object. If something like a paper, it can last for 24 hours. In a hard surface like steel, it can last for 48 hours. Or in other hard object, it can last in 72 hours. So how can we apply into our practice? You take 4 masks. Okay. So the first mask you use for first day, you put it in a plastic cover and keep it. Don't take to your home. Second day, you use another mask. Third day, you use a third one. And fourth day, you use a fourth one. Okay. By the time you reach the fifth day, the 72 hours is over for the first mask. So virus would have been completely eradicated from that without having any sterilization technique. So you can very well use the day one mask on the day 5 again. Okay. So if you have 4 masks, and one mask can be used for 5 days. So if you have 4 N95 masks, for the whole month, you can use that. Okay. So this has to be practiced in dental practice. I feel this is not the one created by me. This is created by the US authorities. This has been practiced in all the ICUs across the world now, and I think it can be adopted in our practice as well. The sterilization technique, I'm not going into the details. It will be bit difficult. And there are different masks, and again, the filtering capacity. Even a normal handkerchief will be having a filtering capacity of 30%. Yourself and your friend, if is wearing 30+30, it can go up to a 60%. Again, just my assumption may not be correct, but it can filter the droplet and prevent infecting others if you're an asymptomatic person. So if an individual is infected, the droplet can go through the your hands, the coat, or the other procedures, or can be having a direct contact, or like a droplet, if it is small, can be airborne, and it can also infect others. So see, this is only a very, very minimal part, maybe during an aerosol generating procedure. All other thing, you need a droplet precaution. That is why you should use a proper hand hygiene. The transmission-based precautions are again standard contact precautions. And for any suspected case, you have to take airborne precautions also. So two points to consider that the patient fulfills the case definition criteria for the disease. So if any contact with that, definitely you should take all precautions, or if your clinic is not having enough facilities, don't take such patients. What type of procedure will be the patient undergoing? I think your association has given a clear-cut guideline on that. Where the patient is located, whether the patient is from a hotspot or a returned person, what is the infectious agent, is mode of transmission, which we have already discussed, is there any risk of contamination, which we have already mentioned, and what type of PPE. So these things should be known, and these are the procedures like bronchoscopy, surgery, tracheal intubation, etc. in our field, and what are the dental procedures with aerosol generation. It is there in the document, and depending on that, you can decide which are the areas these N95 masks should be used. Even in the ICU, we are not using N95 mask. N95 mask is limited for the persons with suspected COVID patients. Other patients, we are using only a normal surgical mask, and even in US, UK or NHS, only for aerosol generating procedures, they are giving N95 mask. Or even if a patient is admitted without symptoms, a normal surgical mask is enough. And again, one thing you should understand is eradicating this disease is impossible. We will have to live along with this disease. So this is regarding the hand rub and effect, efficacy. This is just paper. I thought it will be helpful for you as well. Even if you dilute the hand rub, we always recommend it is more than 80%. You can see even if it is diluted many times, even more than 40% will be having an excellent viral killing power for even if you use for 20 seconds. Okay, so any surgical hand rub will be good enough to control these things. Regarding the treatment, I can keep on talking for another half an hour, but again, because of time constraints, I'm not using. But always keep in mind the hydroxychloroquine, even though recommended by ICMR, it is not having any evidence. The recent studies are all negative about hydroxychloroquine. I will never recommend hydroxychloroquine prophylaxis, even though ICMR has stated that, but that is without any proper homework, I would like to say. And regarding the algorithm of management, what we are doing right now is the patient without any symptoms or oxygen requirement, or patient with oxygen requirement or requiring mechanical ventilation. A patient without symptoms nor risk factors actually doesn't need much treatment. With risk factors, you can consider hydroxychloroquine or azithromycin, but again, it is debated nowadays. If patient are requiring oxygen requirement, the convalescent sera, interferon, etc., can be tried. Or sick patients also, we can use convalescent sera or the antiviral drug remdesivir or the biological agent tocilizumab. Because of shortage of time, I'm not going too much into the details. So thank you so much for giving me an opportunity to interact with you. I'm really sorry that I have exceeded the time, because I was given some points to cover and I was trying to cover all those areas. You can note my email ID and again personal WhatsApp. If you have any queries later on also, you can feel free to contact me. We have also have another platform called Webinar Campus. We have a FB page also. All the talks what we are doing, like again, many experts also we are getting every day evening. We have a talk, like sessions on evening 7 to 8:30. So those persons interested can visit our website. So thank you so much, and we.